Hey everyone, so this time I got another question which is kind of related to my blog. As you may know, I actually give permission to attempt to hack my blog, so yeah, just go ahead and try it. Just don't touch the server isn't really mine, but if you want to go after the website, just do it. And that being said, one thing I do is I put some funny pictures and also a honeypot in one place. So using the honeypot you can actually hack an admin panel and then add a blog post, and the blog post will be displayed on the blog. Now, only on the Polish side of a blog though, for example, this is one of the examples of such blog posts, but it will be only visible to you. And that's actually intended, and if you try to send a link to somebody else to this exact hacked blog post, you will see a funny picture, and it's one of the collectible pictures I have on my blog, so this is one way to find them, sorry for the spoilers. Now, I get an interesting question because somebody noticed that, okay, so they added the blog post, right, and it's obvious that it's visible for them, but if they clear the cookies, clear the cache, or like enter incognito mode, let's do just that, they can still see the blog post. What's up with that? There are no cookies. How am I tracking the person? How do I know how to display the blog post? Now, there is no magic here. I actually take the user agent and the IP and treat that as a unique pair by which I identify whoever added the blog post. So if I would run another browser like Firefox, then the message would not be here. Now, this actually brings me to an interesting topic, which is how can you track users and how are users being tracked? And this is purely from a technical perspective. I'm not saying you should track users. I'm saying that these are the technical possibilities that someone can track you, be it for a good purpose or whatever else purpose there is, right? So there are basically two things to think about. Well, the most basic mechanism to establish a session, as in basically verify the identity of a client to confirm that this is the same client which was a request before, we use cookies, right? That's pretty obvious. Now, there are actually a lot more values which you can store on a browser of a given client, of a given user, than just the cookie, and one of the examples is the e-tag. Now, let's do a test, a quick test. I'm going to run, well, not even an HTTP server. I'm going to just run netcat, which is going to create a listening socket on port 80, which is the HTTP port, and I do have a reply packet ready, so I will connect with a browser to this, and then I will reply with this packet. Now, this packet is a little special because it contains an e-tag. An e-tag is used for caching, but actually it can also be used for, well, as a cookie. So the e-tag doesn't have any special cache-related format. It can be anything, like whatever message can be put here, like in this example. Let's see how the browser behaves. So I'm going to enter, well, localhost, but the port is wrong, and test. And as you can see, no e-tag is currently sent, actually no cookies are sent either. I'm going to reply with this packet. Yes, I want to enter this. And well, the page did render. And now I'm going to do another connection with the browser. And as you can see, we got another header this time, if non-match, and the message that we put in an e-tag. So an e-tag is just another example of how you can store a value at a client, right? So to go with this a little further, somebody created what was called an ever cookie. An ever cookie was a cookie. That person was, by the way, Sami. And it was basically a cookie which uses all known at the time methods of storing a value at a browser. And if you go to Wikipedia, I will, by the way, post all the links I have here for you today under the video. If you go to Wikipedia, you will know that it will, you will learn that it used, for example, the HTTP cookies, the e-tag, web cache, local storage, session storage, and so on and so on. So basically all the mechanisms which allow you to store a value on the client browser from server side or acting as a website owner. Now, this isn't actually the only way to track a user, track a session, right? It's the so-called active way. Now, there is also something called the fingerprinting. Fingerprinting is basically, let's put it this way. Your browser isn't really unique. Your computer system, however, is. So, you might be using Chrome, right? And a lot of people might be using Chrome. But if you add to that things like what fonts you have installed, what resolution you're using, what video card is available for WebGL, how is the canvas rendered, which pages you visited, though this is actually kinda out of a picture for cross browser, but that's another topic. I would not go into that today. But if you add that together, it turns out that our browsers and our computer systems as a whole turn out to be unique, right? And by unique, I mean, if somebody has this browser fingerprint and they enter another website and the website checks the fingerprint again, this usually involves running JavaScript, quite a lot of it, then that means that's probably the same session. And there are several web pages which do check it. I run, for example, on miunique.org my fingerprint, so this is for my browser, which you see here. And there are some unique things which are, for example, my content language is pretty unique because I do have it somewhat customly set in the browser in Chrome, right? So only 0.10% of other people who tested their browser on this website have the same content language as I do, and that already makes me quite unique. Well, this browser quite unique because it's again about tracking the session between browsers and not really the user, right? Then there is the list of plugins, then there is stuff like, for example, how the canvas is being rendered, because this also turns to be unique for a given system. So for example, on Linux, you would render the canvas in a little different way. The anti-aliasing for fonts would be done in a different way. Each browser would do the font rendering in a different way, and so on and so on. Also, the browser version, even if you spoof it, it might actually come out here or with other JavaScript features. Then, it seems my graphic cards is being offered as part of the WebGL renderer, which does make some sense. And this combined with all the other stuff which you see here actually makes my browser quite unique. So it's really possible that only I have this given fingerprint. There are other websites which either document the ways fingerprints can be made of a browser, or also offer to get a different kind of a fingerprint of your machine. So again, I'm going to post the links down under my video. And yes, I guess that's about it for today. So keep in mind that there is the cookies, and I guess clearing the cookies and the cache isn't really the protection enough to basically protect you from your browser from being tracked across sites. And I guess that's kind of the environment we're currently living in, right? Cool. So that's it, and see you next time. Bye bye.